Right? Shall we, let's begin with a word of prayer together. Our Father, we thank you so much for your grace and your mercy in keeping us safe, that we are spared once again from a virus outbreak. We look around us and we see the ongoing battle within our own country, all over the world. Help us to never take for granted the position, the place that we have found ourselves in. We pray that we will cherish this moment and use it to cultivate our faith and to make it stronger. Help us this morning to help us to consider what ministry is all about. Not just to rejoice in our own safety and blessing, but to be even more conscious to reach out to other people with the gospel message, to learn to minister together as a church. We ask that you would bless us. In Jesus' name, amen. This morning, we continue our study from 2 Corinthians and chapter 4. And this is a good text for us an opportunity for us to learn a little bit more of what ministry is. What is church ministry all about? Oh, this is good. From time to time, you know, it's like a refresher, it's a reminder, it could be good instruction for those perhaps are new. But again, we learn. What does it mean we speak about ministry. We may even say we are in ministry, but what is that really all about? Okay, so we must have always a biblical perspective in this here and align our life, our own church to this. That's why we want to continue to study the Lord's Word constantly, to keep on aligning ourselves with the Scriptures all the time, personal, together as a church, right? Now, let's consider this, okay, and we take a look at 2 Corinthians. Let's begin again with chapter 4, 1, review a little bit, and Paul says, we have this ministry. When can we say we have this ministry? Not at the start. Because new, when Paul first started out, he couldn't say we have this ministry. You're just starting out. You're still learning. You're still understanding, right? So go with Barnabas. Go and bring gifts over to Jerusalem. Come back. Now, learning to be faithful, right? Along the way, he will teach. Along the way, he will preach. And then he began to realize there is a gift of teaching and preaching and study of the Lord's Word. And bit by bit, it's not in your initial year. Right? Seeking the Lord to establish ministry. Same for Moses. He began with fear, didn't know what it was, so he was afraid. God had to help him, first, overcome your own fears. Second, now, exposure, experience, seek the Lord further. It takes time to be established that you can say, I understand what ministry is, that we have this ministry. This is what God has given or entrusted to us. Right? What is this ministry? Now, Paul can take a look at chapter 3, verse 6. This is called the ministry of the new ministers of the new covenant. Or the ministry of the new covenant. God has made us. Now, that's got to happen. God working in your life. God is the one who will make you sufficient as ministers of the new covenant. And this is not just the apostles or the pastors. This is a reference to believers, to the church who understand this. God makes us together as ministers. So it's not confined to just apostleship alone, right? The preaching of the gospel, essentially, the ministry of the gospel is, that's what it is, essentially. And it's called this, the focus here is that of the new covenant of the Lord Jesus Christ, right? Now, chapter 3, verse 8. And he talks about how the ministry of the Spirit of God is, this is called the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Feature, not human spirit, right? Not human spirit, not human wisdom, not your own ideas. The inspiration must come from the Holy Spirit. And where would the Spirit of God lead and teach from the Scriptures? Right? The Lord Jesus Christ. This is John 14:15. So, the New Covenant, Holy Spirit, just to tell us, this is not human wisdom, human spirit. This is called the ministry of the Holy Spirit, even if human beings are involved in ministry, right? The Spirit of God must be feature, indwelling people. We must look for people who are filled with the Spirit of God to serve the Lord effectively in ministry. Obviously, right? So that's what we look for. John, Acts chapter 6 is another reference. Who do they look for? People full of faith, wisdom, full of the Holy Spirit. So Paul now puts together these principles, teaching. And when he says, we have this ministry, these things are now in mind. New covenant, obviously has to do with the Lord Jesus Christ, the gospel, forgiveness of sin, faith in Jesus, and all that is in the new covenant. Holy Spirit, He inspires, He empowers, He enables. Right? Ministry of the Holy Spirit. Now, verse 9, we go on further. The ministry, this is in contrast of condemnation, had glory, and that's the ministry of righteousness exceeds much more glory. So we must look at it. This is truly a glorious ministry. A ministry of righteousness, where through the preaching of God, the gospel, when people come to faith in Jesus, God, remember, we talk about justified by faith, right? God imputes His righteousness. The new believer learns to live righteously for God. They must be taught the Scriptures that they may grow in their faith, grow spiritually, grow in righteousness, ministry of righteousness. So it doesn't end with, I'm saved. See, this is why people talk about the sinner's prayer is so defective, because it covers none of these things. None of it. There is no, this. Okay, I've said it. What? Where is the righteousness part? Where is the Spirit of God part indwelling? That we may know God, that we may be enlightened, that we may walk with God, that we may live righteously for God, serve Him in righteousness, grow in righteousness in character and life, ministry. That's what ministry is. Consistently, continuously teaching. That, see, Paul will go preach the gospel. Lead, that there will be those who reject it. There will be those who come to faith in Christ. Then he will come back, strengthen the church, teach them further. Write to them if he cannot be there physically. To instruct them. This is how we live by faith. The just shall live by faith. Romans. Who is the just? The righteous. Those who have really come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. God will enable them to live now righteously for him, to battle sin, to overcome sin. Guess who we need? The Holy Spirit. Right? That's ministry. In a nutshell. So when we say we have this ministry, it includes, in essence, this is it. It's expressions, preaching the gospel. It's in applied teaching, instructing, applied evangelism, right? Whether in the church or outside the church, sharing with people the gospel. Applied funeral ministry, comforting hearts, pointing people back to God that they may find comfort, sharing with people the Lord's word. Becomes a ministry. Now, this week over in Singapore, another ministry, a federal ministry, back to back. Matthew Ng, used to be an overseas student here, grandma passed on. But this is a ripe old age of over 90 years old, battling dementia for over 10 years. And that is tough, really, really tough. Now, what came out of it was, you know, how the treasure, the preciousness of the gospel, that she came to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ through the ministry of the church there in Bethany. And then a few years later, dementia. That was really, really tough. And the joy is that she came to know the Lord, even in her evening years where she struggled, where she lost memory of so many things. In an amazing way, she never forgot the Lord. That is an absolute amazing thing. She remembers the Lord Jesus. She remembers she's a Christian. She remembers hope. That's the only thing that I thought that was pretty amazing. To have that shared in her funeral. That we don't know what can happen to us. You see, ministry becomes even, must be understood. It's from the Lord. It's not something we create. We are privileged to be part of, so we must learn. How do we minister? How can we be ministers of the new covenant? I must learn. I must be instructed carefully. The Spirit of God, how does that fit in? Ministry of righteousness. Well, righteousness must be that key feature, not unrighteousness. Righteousness. Right? When we serve the Lord, clean hearts, clean hands, please. Not just clean books. Clean books, clean hearts, clean hands. Righteousness must be key here. Okay, now let's go on further. He says, as we, now say the connection, as we have received mercy. Right? Now, we have this ministry. This ministry is tied into God's mercy. We have received mercy. The mercy in saving us through ministry. True? Through the ministry of the gospel, we were saved. The mercy of God stands out to us. So it is by His mercy that we were saved through the ministry of the Lord, the new covenant of the Spirit of God, righteousness, ministry. Then, God's mercy again, making us sufficient. Now, Paul speaks about this. And then, mercy in enabling us. So, we see the mercy of the Lord. Not just human effort. And this COVID has showed us how much we need the Lord's mercy. We can plan. Let's have all these things here. And then shut down. Your plans have to change. Then we realize, oh Lord, we need your mercy. Again, seeking the Lord's mercy. See, sometimes either we are conscious of God's mercy or we are not. We can experience mercy and then call it luck. Right? To me, it is really the mercy of God. This guy was in our community and he didn't affect anybody. And then there will be people who will say, well, maybe he's not, you know, it was a false thing. You know, whether it was false or real or what, you know, we just dodged a bullet. Can we not take a moment and thank God for his mercy? Honestly, we don't know. Well, we trust that he was truly tested. You know, all those things was done right. And then it was positive. Nobody understand why he didn't affect. I wouldn't be. I would just be thankful he didn't. Because if he did, we are not going to be physically here this morning. Right? That meant sometimes it's just hard to understand these things. The moment, thank God. Right? Then there was a danger and you escaped it. Wow. If you look at it, rather than, wow, I was very lucky. I just look at it and think, my, that is a Lord's. I would rather spend the time just thank God for his mercy each day than maybe there's a conspiracy theory somewhere. Why waste your time? Why waste your energy? Because the fact is you don't know. But what is true, God is truly, you know, again, mercy. Really merciful. Right? Then this is what Paul said. Hey, remember this. He went through a lot. He suffered a shipwreck. He got beaten half to death, left to die. Wild beasts attacked him. People throw rocks. How come he didn't die? He was lucky. Now, your mercy. His word is, we have received mercy, much mercy. And he says this outright, we have this ministry, we have received mercy. Truly. Thank God for mercy, for life, for ministry, and for more. Each day, just thankful. I was talking to one, she used to worship with us. Now she's a Mandy. Remember Mandy? She keeps in touch. And so she's in Malaysia, and I said, look, she says, I heard you all had a lockdown. I said, yeah, we, one case, and the whole entire place got locked down, and we're thankful that we're out of that. And she said, wow, you know, Malaysia is really in a bad place. And she's, you know, and yet she says, I'm just thankful each day that we can be provided for our needs each day. Just thankful for each day's needs met. That's it. You know what? That should be it. That we should be even more thankful. Now, I hope this morning you come to church thankful. One, you don't need to wear masks. If you've got respiratory problem, if you are older, you can't breathe, if you fainted, I wouldn't know. I thought you would be just resting. I wouldn't know. It's tough. Right? Just thankful that you can breathe fresh air. Thankful that you can, just to gather again. That is, just be thankful. That would be wonderful. We have received mercy, right? It was tough beginning of the week, but mercifully got through. Well, I'm very grateful my sister is back home. I was very, very worried that she's going to be stuck on Christmas Island. Not that she's enjoying herself. But she, of course, she had to have to, a lot of hard work. But thank God, in time, we can have dinner. Just maybe simple pleasures, we call it, of life. But thank God for his mercy that we can be together. Right? Now, look at that. This is for ministry. Now, don't lose heart. Now, this is the next part. Remember, it concludes. We have received ministry, mercy, thank God for his mercy. We don't lose heart. Don't lose heart. Let this experience of the Lord's mercy encourage you. Okay, what are the challenges, right, they will face in ministry, in life, in whatever? The Lord's mercy must become a bit more real to you. Don't lose heart. Okay, press on. Okay, now let's take a look. We got to read further some of these challenges, and there will be challenges. We must understand this, almost expect this. I do, right? So these things don't take me off. I caught surprise. Whoa, how come this happened? No. When you see this, it can happen. Just be prepared as best you can, physically, practically, and mentally. Who knows? 2 weeks later, we get told, you know, while we are eating lunch again, lockdown. Be mentally prepared. Okay? How? Don't lose heart. Okay? Just be as prepared as you can. Things can come, problems can come, and we just have to prepare as best we can. Now, what were the problems we've referenced? These are same challenges. Let's talk ministry here, church ministry in particular. These problems continue to exist today. All right? So there will be... Now, look at some of these ministry. Paul talks about don't lose heart. He mustn't lose heart. He must not give up. He mustn't throw in the towel, because these challenges are going to be fierce. But verse 2, we have renounced the hidden things of shame, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience. Now, there is renouncing false teaching. Right? This is a continuous problem today. Hidden things of shame. Right? In the early days, there was this teaching, false teaching going around, Gnostic teaching. That talks about, you know, there is secret knowledge somewhere. Only if you join, you will know this secret knowledge. This is today's word, is called a cult. So there are things like that. You got to watch out very, very carefully. Right? There are false teaching, hidden things, secret things. Now, there are walking in craftiness. Today, you have the same problem. There are churches promising healing, promising health, promising wealth. Today, it is a huge thing in the U.S. They making empty promises left, right, center all the time. This is not a new thing. Way back then, same problem. Peddling the word of God, handling the word of God. So they twist whatever they take from the scriptures and they go and apply it. Well, I heard one preacher say, he used the parable of the sower. Used the parable of the sower. Right? You're sowing and the different hearts. And he says, you see, 30-fold, 60-fold. And he used it with reference to, if you sow to God's kingdom, then God will give you 30-fold, 60-fold. And he's talking money. If you give 10,000 to God, God will bless you 30% increase. If you give God 1 million, you could be more. I just said, you serious? This was a mega church. City Harvest Church, to be exact. I said, you serious? So I was sent this video clip. I said, it cannot be right. The parable of the sower is not about money. It's about the word of God being sown into hearts. Literally doing what Paul is renouncing, handling the word of God deceitfully. This is what we have to be. We must handle the word of God correctly, not deceitfully, truth. Teach it as it is, right? And What is the word of God? How is it meant to be handled? Manifestation of the truth. The truth of God's word must be revealed. So meticulously, we compare texts. Bit by bit, you know, compare, find connecting texts elsewhere to explain further so we have a better understanding of what it actually is. Right? So in the month, for 2 months, we've been looking at the theme, loving kindness of God. Okay, it's from Psalm 36. And then looking at it, examining at it, mercy, faithfulness, righteousness, judgment. All this is part of the loving kindness of God. And then bit by bit, it takes that time for you to see the truth of the Lord's word. Careful work that the truth of God may be revealed. Right? That's our challenge to help all the time for ourselves, for others. But we must renounce that which is false. We will, this is not right, we will renounce. In other words, no part of it.
Sorry, could you repeat what you said?
Sorry. Siri responded. Yeah.
It's all good.
Okay. Yeah, here's the problem. I don't know how to switch it off. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, maybe I will put it somewhere. Give me a moment. Sorry, can we pause? Just in case Siri talks back. There are embarrassing moments in life, and this is one of them. Okay, you know, I don't want to say Siri renounced it too. Right? Okay, we can continue now. Okay, well, let's take a look at it. Okay, so renouncing false teaching. Let's take a look at verse 3. And then verse 3, look at the whole idea of, this is really challenging. Okay? Even if our gospel is veiled. Remember, we were talking about the idea of the veil covering and then blindness and all that, spiritual blindness and can't see, okay? And it is veiled to those who are perishing. That is just a sobering word, okay? What does this mean? You see, those who are perishing, not that they are not given a chance to hear the gospel, to know the gospel. The perishing part comes when you reject the gospel. I hear it, I know what you're saying, I reject it. Here's the problem. Now, let's tie this in with what Jesus said, okay? Just put a bookmark there or something that would help you. And take a look at John chapter 4. Okay. Now we know, John chapter 3, not John chapter 4. John, remember the famous John 3:16. For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. In essence, this is the gospel message. In its essence, this is the gospel message. God, the Lord Jesus, believing in him, not perish, have eternal life. Right? Now, let's go further. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world. True. Right? But the world through him might be saved. That is God's intention, God's will, God's purpose. But remember, man has a choice. Look at this. He who believes in him is not condemned. They will not perish. They will not be condemned. Hence, not perish. Now, but here's the other side. He who does not believe is condemned already. We're not talking about the final judgment. What is this condemnation? Because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son. Now, this is the condemnation. What is the condemnation? The light that has come into the world, right? This is the kind of, that the light, which is Jesus, came into the world, and men loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. They loved for darkness. So why would some reject the gospel, reject the Lord, reject ministry? They don't want to hear it. Now, here is an insight from the Lord Jesus himself. There are those who would love darkness rather than light. Everyone practicing evil hates the light. This is resistance. Expect resistance. Not everybody is going to warm up to it. We are not going to make the gospel more attractive. You got to say it as it is. Oh, but what if those, they don't like it? And then they don't like it. It's their loss, you know. We are not going to pander to their, oh, if you don't do this for me, then I'm going to reject your gospel. Then you reject it. That is no compromise. Why would they reject it? There is a love for darkness, a hate for the light, a hate for truth, because the deeds, this to God is evil. He does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. They don't want to be exposed. What they're really thinking, deep down inside them. They will give opinions. They will come to church and give opinions and criticize the message, the messenger, members of the church, anyone they can think of, they will do it. But they will not see the darkness inside them. This is what's there. But he who does the truth, comes to the light. Deeds may be clearly seen that they have been done in God. Now, those who are sincere, those who are genuinely seeking God and truth, you know what? They will come. So you don't worry. You just, manifestation of the truth is reveal truth, explain truth, teach truth. This is what we want to do. And those who want this, they'll come. We're not selling anything. We're not saying, you see, we're not using any form of thing to attract anyone. Certainly not our lunch ministry. We cook because after worship, no, sorry, today no lunch. You only get breakfast, so eat up. Right? But we cook because during the week it was a bit hard to prepare and all that. But next week we hopefully can have lunch if we don't get locked down. Right? We prepare this lunch so our members can have fellowship, you don't have to go all over the place and can be there. We cook for our people. But if there are other people who happen to come and worship, you are welcome. But our lunch ministry is not used as a, well, we don't want to attract you. Neither is our youth ministry. Neither. What is the attraction? Jesus. Truth. Gospel. And if you are interested, you will come. You will come. Right? So that is what the Lord said, and Paul is the one who explains this even further. There are those, as if there's a veil, they will resist. They will reject. Now, he explains this darkness a little bit more. It's a little bit more sinister than we realize. One, it is a human part. The rejection is your part, right? You don't want the light to expose what you're really thinking inside you. You don't want to see your own sins. You don't want to deal with it. Now, there's something else that would promote that kind of life. Okay, we go back to chapter 4 and we see the God of this age. This is a reference to Satan. In Ephesians, he's called the prince and the power of the air, meaning invisible. Not that Satan is God. He isn't. Like God of this age, of this generation, you have no idea how influential the evil one is over this generation. In fact, over every generation. Behind it. Now, I'm not talking some conspiracy theory somewhere. This is his influence. It is bigger than all the things that you are seeing around, all over the world. In every aspect of life, even in families, even in churches. That is a scary. Can he influence? What is his influence? He will blind you. The God of this world has blinded their hearts, their minds. Now, this is it. Remember, the heart is used, the mind is used, your perception. You reject light, you reject truth. You don't want anything to do with the Word of God. You know what you are exposing yourself to? The evil one's work to blind your mind. He will take over. This is why Jesus said, this is a parable. The Word of God is sown into your heart. You don't want it, the evil one takes it away. You don't want it? You don't want to go deeper? You don't want to go further? He takes it away. You don't want to understand it? He takes it away. Paul explains what Jesus taught further. The God of this world, their minds, he has blinded. So this is what we are up against. False teaching. There will be people. Now, there are those who quietly reject and they just walk away. But there are those who violently reject and they are not going to walk away. There are people like that too. So we got to prepare for it. Right? There will be this. It's invisible, but it's there. Resistance from the evil one will be there. His part will influence people to not be able to understand the Lord's word and to find faith in him. Anything he can do to take away the possibility of creating faith in God, he will. He will. Okay? So we've got to know this. He will resist truth. And so on the one hand, you could explain and share with people. On the other hand, those who reject, you're going to be open. The evil one will be allowed to blind you. This is why Paul says, unless a person turns to the Lord, that veil is removed. The only person who can defeat and overcome the power of the evil one is not your willpower, it's the Lord. You have no power over the evil one. He's called the God of this age, meaning more powerful than you. You don't even know how influenced you can be. That is that scary. Mind blinded. Everything you see, you see darkness. You can't make sense of truth. The only way is to turn to the Lord. Let him remove that veil that you may see. This morning I'll be speaking on Psalm 36. Next part following on, in your light we see light. And this is very much New Testament, as much as Old Testament, right? So today we look at the New Testament, this morning in Sunday school, and then later on you see it in the Old Testament, this whole idea of enlightenment light that we really, really need. Of course, the fullness of that light is in Christ, but we got to turn to the Lord. He removes that veil. That light must come. Now, let's go on further to see this, okay? The challenges then, our challenge must be this, to be faithful to the ministry given to us. That's what Paul did. So this is what we want to do. We have this ministry. Can we say that at Bethel now? After what, 25, 26 years? Can we say we have this ministry, the ministry of preaching the gospel? Is this what we are known for? That we will preach the truth of the gospel, that we will teach God's word, that we will help people who believe in Jesus to grow in their faith, in their walk with the Lord, with God's word. Can we say we have this ministry? That we will equip people with God's word. Can we say that? That's our challenge. We know the challenges are there. We will renounce false teaching. We will tell people this is what we stand for, the Lord's word, the truth that is there, and we make you no promises of health, wealth, and all those things. We will not promise you healing either, but we will pray for you. But we make no such promises. Right? Now, we will tell you our concern is the gospel, eternal life, life of righteousness. Right? Now, that's our concern. Now, what is our challenge? Understanding all these things, faithful. Our challenge is to, opposite of deceitful, handle the word of God correctly. It's like what Paul said, manifestation of the truth. You must help people to see it. So I do go through. Now, there are people who oppose, even have commented, why does Pastor Chris go through everybody's work? I don't demand it. It's up to you. But I will encourage you, because this part I'm concerned is for truth. Right? To go through, make sure you share truth. Well, Ed does that. I didn't ask it, but he respectfully sends over, okay, make sure, is it okay? And, you know, that is a very respectful thing to do. He's being much older than I am, and yet he's got to do that. Appreciate that. Uncle Esty later on will be sharing his testimony. Now, I didn't ask him. He would write out his group and go through with me two, three times. This is like-mindedness. We just share we want to be as close to the truth as we possibly can and employing whatever help we can. Oh, that's good. You know, manifesting of the truth. Again, like what Paul says earlier, commending ourselves to every man's conscience. What is this? Meaning to say, in the sight of God, our conscience must be clear. Right? We must be consistent in our life and our ministry. Consistency. You know, say one thing, do another thing. Don't do that. We must be consistent. Right? Now, preaching the gospel, handling, it must involve the word of God, as we read here, not deceitfully, but handle it well. So our approach to evangelism is word of God. We share with people Jesus. We share with people the teachings of Jesus. We share with people the scriptures too, old and new, right? And of course, we must speak about godly wisdom and the authority that comes from God himself and power from the Lord's word when it is. There is power in God's word in itself. Right? Now, look at verse 4. Then we see all this coming together. Right? Verse 4, the last part. Remember, there are the God of this age, and the only thing to overcome this is that this part, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. How do you overcome darkness? Light. The light of the gospel that reveals the glory of Christ. The gospel presents Jesus as in the image of God. So there's a content there. The idea of the imagery of light, that you may see this is who Jesus is, glory, and the image of God, and then the light that shines in the dark, right? That shine on them. Verse 5, we do not preach ourselves. That's very important, right? The focus of the gospel is not ourselves, but Christ Jesus. We may use ourselves as illustration of God's grace, of God's mercy, saving us, of product of the gospel. But the focus is Jesus Christ the Lord. Ourselves, we are bond servants for Jesus' sake. Right? Verse 6, for it is God. See, this is God's part. There's our part, we be faithful. Be faithful to the truth. Be faithful in handling God's word. Be faithful in living it out in your conscience, in good conscience. And God's part, it is God who commanded light to shine out of the darkness, who has shone in our hearts to give light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. This is what enlightenment is all about. The power of the gospel. His light shines in the heart, dispels the darkness that is there. So one, we need to turn to the Lord. He removes the veil that we may see. The veil can be gone, but the darkness can be still there. Now, He needs to shine into our heart. He creates within our heart light, enlightened. That's Paul's prayer of enlightenment, Ephesians 1. That you, there may be spirit of wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, that you may be enlightened. This is what it is, to the knowledge of the Lord. Right? This is the part I can't do. I can't. You can explain truth. You can share. You can live it out. But if, you know, I can't create that light. This is God's part. So when you see people coming to faith in the Lord, you cannot but thank God for His mercy. Whether it is in the aged care or whether it is in Bethel in our midst, it is the Lord's mercy. Then you know you have this ministry. The Lord is there blessing it. The Lord is there enabling it. The Lord is there enlightening. It is not all you. But if the Lord is not there, there's nothing you can do. Right? So this, you know, this is our challenge, and to that which is given to us, and our task is to remain true and faithful to this ministry. Now, any questions you want to raise up? Right? Just give 10 minutes if you want to. I thought, you know, if you want to interact further with this, we can. But in a nut, you know, could you see the flow of thoughts here in Corinthian text over here? 2 Corinthians. Okay, to those who need to prepare breakfast, yeah, thank you. Thank you. So they need to just leave a bit earlier because they are preparing breakfast for us. Okay, right? So do you see the whole thing? Right? We have this ministry. We're wonderful. Of course it's wonderful. We can say this after many years. Our challenge is to remain faithful. In our first year, second year, third year, fourth, same thing. It takes for me a decade for myself personally. Now I can safely say, we have this ministry, but are you going to hold firm to it? Remain faithful to it? That is a big challenge. You may have it, and then you can give it up for other things. Right? Don't give it up. Don't lose heart. Sometimes you feel, how come you're the only one that is there? Don't lose heart. You are not the only one. Okay, so don't be like Elijah. Well, I'm the only one. You are not the only one. You may feel you're the only Christian in your workplace. You may be feeling you're the only Christian in your family. See, we take for granted that we have family members that are believers. But then not everybody has. You may be feeling, but don't lose heart. Be that light wherever you are. Right? Living the Lord's word out. Be that light. In your school, in your work, in your family, certainly in your church, please. Now, be that light. Be that source of, to me, this is blessing. True blessing. He enlightened. The light of the Lord is there. You know what? That is a wonderful blessing. Paul goes on to say that, you know, walk as children of light. There we go. As opposite to that which is darkness. We will renounce this. We are You know, we understand there will be people who will reject. We must be aware of the resistance of the evil one. Right? You renounce, people can get angry. You know what? You can get angry. We're not going to get angry. We're just going to say, we're not doing this. Right? There will be resistance. Expect this. Our challenge is to remain faithful, true. Okay? And may the Lord continue to enlighten and help people to come to faith in the Lord. This is the power of the gospel. There is power in the gospel. And we are just absolutely amazed how that works out. How does it work? Of course, we talk about prayer, but our part is critical, where we will help people know the Lord and His Word. That is vital. Okay? So when we say, how come the struggles, the problems, the resistance, all there? Hey, it's all in the Scriptures. It's all there. Okay? So we will share the gospel with people. And if people reject it, people reject it. Right? So we're very glad we could go back to aged care next week. And same thing, you know, when right now confined to 3 people. So it's Aldine, it's myself, and then there's Ed. You know, we will do our part. We will share our faith. We will share the Word of God. And if people reject it, you know what? People reject it. But we will do our part to just do our best at the gospel is shared. Right? Same thing here in the church. The biggest mission field today, you know where it is? It's not overseas. It's not even around. It's right in the church. It's a big mission field out here, right here. Right? Well, let's be equipped as best we can. Really, as best we can, to know the Lord's Word, to be enlightened. Really be enlightened enough that we can see the reality of the Lord's Word coming alive to us. And you know what? Share it. Live it out. Okay? And to me, this is a wonderful Chinese New Year, Lunar New Year blessing when we can see the light of the Lord like this. Right? Anything or not? Otherwise, I will end here. Anything else you want to add on, you want to raise up, or right? I think we know what the challenge is. Let's remain true. Let's remain faithful, right? To the ministry that has been given to us, and it has been given to us. I see this in this is not. I take it even more personally because you know this has been given to me, entrusted. I may not have begun with Bethel. Was I there all 26 years when it started? The answer is no. Right? Didn't know the Lord back then. And now I do. I take this upon myself. You know what? I, being part of it, coming to faith in the Lord here, growing further here, being given an opportunity to serve here, and then over the years, entrusted, want to be faithful. Be faithful, be faithful. This is a word to all. If you have, be faithful. Don't think short term, think long term. Think the Lord establishing you in ministry, is giving you this ministry. Guard it with all your heart. And this is a precious ministry. We have mercy, we have received mercy, ministry given to us. Let's be faithful to the Lord, right? Let the light of the Lord truly shine upon hearts through His Word, through your life, through ministry itself. Okay? All right, well, let's pray together. Our Father, we thank You for this, Your Word, that we can read bit by bit to appreciate how Paul would explain ministry in such detail and such insight. And we pray that this word will give to us that sense of assurance and understanding in how ministry works in our own life and in our church. And we pray that You would enable us to minister effectively for You, to be challenged to grow in our own understanding, our own knowledge of you. Lord, we ask that you would enlighten us, that you will give to us that wisdom and understanding to know your word far better, that we may be made sufficient as ministers of the new covenant too. We pray that you would bless this day of worship and ministry. We pray in Jesus' name.